they flower, when they get fruits, when they leaf out, etc. And one of the reasons that it's important is because when you treat invasive plants, your treatment can have variable effectiveness depending on the life stage that the plant is in. So on the left here, you can see a picture of buffle grass, which is a big problem here in the Sonoran Desert. And when you treat buffle grass with certain herbicides, you want to treat it when it's fully greened up and more photosynthetically active so that your herbicide is more effective. Another reason that invasive phenology is important is because the characteristics of a plant's phenology can in some ways define the ways in which it is invasive. So on the right here we have a myrrh honeysuckle. And the myrrh honeysuckle is known to leaf out earlier and lose its leaves later in the season than native plants in its range. And so that gives it a competitive advantage over those plants. So I wanted to look at what records we have of invasive plant phenology, and then to use those records to try and examine how climate impacts the timing of the onset of things like flowering and leafing. So I use data from two networks. The first is National Phenology Network, where I work, and they operate a citizen science program to collect phenology data. And the advantage of this is that there's a lot of sites where people are collecting data, and they've been doing it a while, so they have more years of data than my other source. But they ultimately have less consistent records because it's just normal people doing this and sometimes they miss a week. The other network I use is the National Ecological Observatory Network. The National Ecological Observatory Network maintains a network of Earth monitoring stations where trained scientists go out and collect tons of measurements, including phenology data. However, they've been operating for fewer years when it comes to invasive plants for the National Phenology Network, and they have much fewer sites. Both of these networks collect this data in the same way, and so I was able to combine their data sets to improve the robustness of my analysis. When I looked at both of the records, these eight species jumped out as having a significant amount of records in both data sets, and I'm not going to go through them all here, but the point is that you have a variety of growth forms, such as grasses, forbs, etc., trees, that are well represented. So I determined the onset of flowering and leafing for each of these plants. So that gives me 16 different periods of onset. And you can see on this graph here, you just have different bands where the onset occurs. And for 6 months leading up to this band of onset, I took monthly summarized climate data from PRISM, which is a gridded climate network. I used precipitation cumulatively, and then daily, average, minimum, and maximum. And I reduced all of this with principal component analysis. Principal component analysis is a method of dimensionality reduction where you maximize the variance in a larger data set by a smaller number of variables, with the most variance being on the first principal component, and then you maximize more on the second, etc. Importantly, these are all independent of one another. So I used these three principal components to do a simple multiple regression against the onset of life stages such as flowering and leafing. So this is one of those models for Lomi ceramachii, which is the myrrh honeysuckle I mentioned earlier. This is modeling the onset of flowering. And for this model, the only significant principal component is principal component one. So here are the loadings for the weighted average that you take of all variables to get principal component one. And what you can see here in the blue is precipitation. It's negative in the first month, and then it has much smaller loadings compared to the minimum and maximum average daily temperatures. And all of the minimum and maximum average daily temperatures are positively contributed to principal component one. So you can say that as temperatures tend to increase, so does principal component one. So when we look at the relation between principal component one and the onset of flowering, you can see that as it increases with increasing temperatures, you tend to see earlier flowering of more honeysuckle. So this is just one of the ways that you can break down these principal components and try and identify the climate drivers of plant phenology. Unfortunately, principal component analysis often leads to messy partial contributions. You can get a ton of positive and negative loadings here. You can get loadings that are much higher in some months than others. And ultimately, that makes many of these models quite difficult to interpret. However, 75% of these models were significant, with R-squared values ranging from 0.1 to 0.6. What I think this means is that there's definitely room for improvement here, both in the number of species for which records are being collected, the number of records that we have for these species. A big issue with this is that generally, land managers and the public want to just yank out invasive species when they find them on the land. They don't want to necessarily let them stick around so they can figure out when they flower. Another issue with this is that there's just a fewer number of sites where the records are being consistently recorded. To improve this analysis, we can always incorporate more variables and incorporate better temporal resolution on these variables. So I only use temperatures and precipitation, but those aren't the only things plants respond to. There are variables such as vapor pressure difference, growing degree days, cooling degree days, photo period, and stuff like that that I think can be used to improve these models in addition to better temporal resolution. Ultimately, though, I'm going to be taking this and other results from my time at the National Phenology Network and delivering what we found to land managers who can use this information to better manage invasive species on our public lands. Thank you.
So how do you plan to deliver your results to land managers?
Actually, recently I was not the only one who gave it, but I helped give a webinar to land managers in the Northeast about the invasive phenology of plants there. And they actually requested information on one of my better performing models here. So that's just one of the ways that we can, you know, connect with researchers and land managers, which is really a big goal of the National.
You model this across the country, right? So some of these species occur in just some spaces, but some would occur really broadly. Are you able to bring in ecosite information about different regions to this?
Well, the